feedback you will get from this.
All right, so this was the last slide we covered. The unique features of MS-DIAL is the true deconvolution, which will become you know, more importantly as we go. Okay, so the question of participant Najeh was, what is the differences between data dependent and data independent analysis? Okay, we will talk about this in a second. MS-DIAL can handle all of these types, which is great. You don't have to worry about switching and learning different software for the type of analysis you have. It's open source. Also, the community is going towards the open source, sharing the codes, because people really want to improve. You know, everybody's contributing, writing comments. If you guys experience any kind of problems with MS-DIAL, you can comment on the GitHub or wherever Hiroshi has set up the MS-DIAL. You can send him an email. It's really a community that is appreciates the feedback of the users. So the vendor or mass spec instrument independent in terms of the software processing. You can process any type of data you have. And processing of LC-MS data acquired in different modes. So this was the question. What are the differences between data dependent and data independent? So very, very often you see in research that people say, okay, I'm just gonna do, you know, profiling. I'm interested, what are the quick differences between control and the treatment samples? Okay, very quick, some short chromatography, I wanna see this. And then they say, I'm not really interested in annotating everything inside. This is not the priority of this project. I just wanna, you know, find some biomarker or whatever. They do MS-1 analysis, then they do data processing, statistical analysis, and what they wanna annotate, in fact, is just the compounds of super high or super low p-value, okay, of high importance. And then they say, oh, okay, I actually have to identify only three compounds. I don't care about everything else, hundreds of metabolites. And then they will say, because there is a few days delay, obviously, from acquiring the data in MS-1 mode, from the time you process your data and you wanna, you know, analyze this compound. So you say, okay, now I know that precursor 751 at retention time, this and this is a compound of my interest. So you go back to the instrument, you set up a method, and you say, okay, now fragment this compound, okay? This is called data dependent acquisition. That means that when you acquire MS-MS data, it is depending on some biological question or on some other you know, reason that you may have to do to acquire the MS-MS data. So, and there are some mixed modes. We really like those guys because one, you wanna reduce, you don't wanna go back to the samples, you just wanna analyze them at once. You wanna get as much information out in one run as you possibly can. This is the, you know, goal. So you can do something like this. You can acquire MS-1 data, okay? And you can say, you can pull the samples together, like 10, maybe, I don't know, 5, or I don't know what is the optimal number of samples to pull together. And you perform on the pool sample analysis, you perform MS-MS. Also, date plus data-dependent acquisition MS-MS. And you can use these pool samples to increase your identification rates, hits, when searching against the libraries. You can do this for every sample, okay? You can say, every sample, I want both. I want MS-1 and MS-2. And there are some other things. There is something called data independent acquisition, MS-MS, SWOT. So SWOT is the sequential window acquisition of all theoretical mass spectra. And there is MS-ALL. It is a similar terminology for two different instrumentation. There is MS-ALL, which is from Waters instrumentation, and SWOT is SciEx instrumentation. So what does it mean? You basically say, you know, when you have a compound of your interest, you wanna fragment it. You say to quadruple, basically, in your acquisition mode, you say,
I am interested in the mass to charge compound 871.3. At this retention time, please isolate this mass and send it to the collision cell for fragmentation. This is basically what you're saying in acquisition mode. But you have to know, you have to have some a priori knowledge why you would want to do this. Sometimes you don't have this, and you still need MSMS for identification. So you say, listen, I'm interested in amino acids, okay? Amino acids, I don't know right now from the top of my head, maybe the mass ranges go from 250 Dalton to 450. I really don't know right now. So you are interested in, you know, something like this. And this is where you would say, okay, this is the window I'm interested in, and I want to fragment everything within this window sequentially, and this is what, without excluding anything, you just set up the mass window and you submit it, and this is what you get as a result. It's just a different terminology for the both of this. We're gonna do some SWOT data processing so we get to see actually one versus another. Okay. And again, in these types of analysis, you lose all of the files for MSMS searching, whereas here you use only one that you acquired MSMS data on for data database matching. All right, another thing is that data-dependent acquisition versus data-independent acquisition is that in data dependent, again, you have activation via collision induced association or CID, and the you are detecting the fragments or the product ions. And another one, you can also do in-source CID. MSO, also I think Agilent or and Ion Mobility Agilent instrument can do this in-source fragmentation. And it is low energy intact molecular spectra and corresponding high energy fragment spectra, without pre-selecting precursors. You just give it a window and say everything within this window, please fragment. And again, when you do something like this, you have to be able to, you have to have a software which is capable of basically stitching back all of the product ions back to the precursor. Product ions, without you knowing which is the precursor, is useless information. You don't, you cannot know, you cannot make any conclusions. Okay, so this is again example of all fragment ions versus SWOT-based MSMS analysis, and the MS-ALL, actually more instrumentation is capable of doing waters, MSE. Again, if you're interested in ion trees, what we do here in these exercises is tandem mass spectrometry, MSMS or MS to the level of 2. But you can also say to some of these instruments, you can say, okay, I'm interested in this precursor and the product ions, and then you take this product ion, the highest abundant product ion from MSMS analysis, and say, please fragment this guy because I'm also interested in substructure of this product ion. And you can basically do this as long as you have ions of good intensities. So this is another type of analysis. It's called, you know, ion trees, and you can create ion trees based on this. And the SWOT is you can, in the SWOT analysis, you can select 1 to 50 mass units window. So you say to an instrument, I want to fragment everything between, I don't know, 200 and 800 Dalton, and I want mass unit window of 20 Dalton. That means from 100 to 120, from 120 to 140. We will have a look at this file, how it looks like, but basically it's just a cycle of repetition off of the ions you would like to have fragmented. Okay, and the instrumentation that is doing this is TripleTOF and SciEx of SciEx and Q-Exactive Thermal. All right. So one of the questions I also posted in the in Piazza, if you are guys using this, is the importance of the deconvolution. So this is not an uncommon thing in mass spectrometry. This happens very often. You have co-eluting peaks, okay? And imagine if you perform some kind of fragmentation, you would get a mixed spectrum like this.
when you want to separate isomers, this is very important, because maybe the fragments actually will be exactly the same, but the ratios of intensities of these isomeric of the product ions from isomers will be different. Okay, maybe the ratio of this guy and this guy is going to be different in isocitrate versus citrate. So you need to make sure which fragments belong to the which precursor, and deconvolution is doing exactly that. Okay, separating the peaks. So this is the overall, outlook off of the MS Dial. You are putting in the raw data, you are converting it to ABF format, you are selecting what type of data analysis are we doing. Do you have data independent MSMS or data dependent MSMS analysis? And then the parts of what MS Dial is doing is A, data collection, peak detection or peak peaking, deconvolution, identification, adduct setting. I believe you guys also covered the formation of adducts with Thomas. Very important. You do not want to have glucose plus sodium and glucose plus ammonium and glucose plus, protonated. You don't want to have these as three different features. You don't want to have unknowns of this. The software has to be able to pick that up and say, oh, this is still glucose. It's just one compound. So, and the gap filling, also explained before. So, there was a question also earlier, I believe. When do you specify deconvolution versus from the peak peaking, am I correct? Or the gap filling? So this is all processed simultaneously. I mean, simultaneously, you set your parameter settings, as I will show you later on. And this is the stepwise how the software is doing this. One thing at a sequentially at a time. You want to be able to visualize the data. You know, nobody wants to look at endless tables. You wanna see the peak shape. You wanna see the peak width. You just wanna see more of your compounds. And then super important feature, what I like, if you guys have Agilent instrumentation, there's a software that comes with it, Mass Hunter, for qualitative analysis, quantitative analysis. And although this software, it provides you a lot, actually, what you can do with it, for you to actually compare within one software the MSMS fragments versus the standards, I believe it's a very, quick confirmation of your doubts. You can do this all within one window. And you can align your compounds. We'll come to this also later. You can visualize it. You can do some basic statistical analysis if you want to. And export, if you prefer doing stuff in R or in any other programming language, you can just export and continue with your analysis. Okay, so raw data input or the formatting of the data depends on the vendor. Agilent chromatograms have .d extension, Bruker's .d, SciEx, WIF, Thermo Fisher and Waters have raw. And all of this can be converted into the ABF. And we have done the downloading for you guys. So you have, there's a folder on each of your laptops. It's called Ivana. Within this, there is an ABF converter. So we're gonna do a small exercise and we're gonna convert the raw files. So what I'm gonna do is, I will just go switch back and forth. I will do the analysis together with you. And I will just go back to the presentation and display what I'm doing on my computer as well. Okay, so there is a folder within Ivana folder. It's called ABF Converter. Also, before I continue, we have three colleagues here. Brian, this is Ben. There is Brian over there, and my colleague and the visiting scientist Gianji. So they are here to help you. If you have any questions or troubles with MS Dial or anything like this, because it will be faster if we just cover our basics this way. Okay, so you guys can open the ABF converter and look at the interface. I'm gonna do this together with you.
There's a shortcut on the desktop.
Just a second.
Oh, you put, okay. You can open it from the desktop. Okay. Everybody opened it? Yes, this is the converter. It's a C. Oh. Okay, so let's start with the P20CHP plasma folder. Okay, it is in ABF files. If in Ivana folder, if you open ABF files, there is a P20CSHP plasma folder. You open it, there is raw Agilent data, and there are .d files. Everybody sees them?
So we open this folder within the converter?
No, no, no. Additionally, you see I have one window here.
Where's the actual window that the rectify window? Where do we find it?
Which window?
The ABF converter.
Oh, it should be on the desktop. See, it's a. It is. Does everybody have that?
It's an icon with a C.
Yes, icon with a C, red C on the desktop.
I have a question. Agilent. I'm assuming this Agilent file is mass handle. Not to the old regular single quad GC mass spec, meaning chem station.
No, it's not chem station. So, but the.
Because I believe chem station dot D capital and this dot D small.
Actually, I'm not familiar with.
Mass Hunter.
So, Mass Hunter is just a software that is processing Agilent data, but the instrument raw file is dot small D. Ben? Brian, do you know capital dot D files? I don't know this. Yeah, me neither. I don't know this. Okay, so we are in the folder of the raw Agilent data. You can click the first one and the last one to select all of these guys, okay? And you just do drag and drop, okay? You drag it to the window where the ABF converter is. You can do one by one. I suggest select all and just drag and drop. Everybody? Yes? Yes? Okay, cool. So let's just hit convert. So when you don't specify the folder, when you don't specify it, the ABF converted files are going to be stored in the same folder as your original files. This is super important for operating MS-DIAL because when we start the analysis of MS-DIAL, you have to be in the folder where your ABF converted files are. Okay, you cannot start the analysis data processing if you're not in the correct folder. This is gonna take 72 minutes, so we can all take a skin. No, just 30. It's just 30. Yeah, again, you know, one of the reasons vendors are producing all these different files is formats is because they also want to sell you the software, obviously. You know, it's all of these companies are developing and putting money into software development. So if they say, oh, we're just going to do .d and the software we are giving you can directly, without any conversion, use this data, of course, this is the motivation for the companies to do this. But if you know, there are also other converters, ProtoWizard, for example. it just cannot convert it to ABF, it can convert it to other formats. If you end up using MZMime or XCMS, you can use ProteoWizard also free of cost. It will just convert the data into MZML, for example, file format. Yes, yes, it is free. You just go on the website. Let me go to the slide. You obviously so it is free, but you cannot really copy it right now from here. You have to be accounted for. You have to state your name and your email address so you can use it. But you cannot copy it and share it and stuff like this. It still has, you know, some limitations in terms of. You can acquire it on your name and everything without any cost. Okay, are you guys still converting or is it just me?
Just maybe restart it.
You think? Oh, it is from Diego. I think Diego has put this. Okay, while I do the conversion, I have actually backups of this, so. Okay, so I have backups, you guys converted, so we're good to go. Okay. So you've seen the process, how it's working, and when you open the folder where the raw data of Agilent was in this CSH Plasma folder, you will have .d files, and right below you will have ABF files. Okay, so information about the samples we will be processing. Obviously, you want to know what type of chromatography was used for your samples because you may need the information. You want to know the information of the background ion, some known contaminants. You know what kind of extraction methods was used, which internal standards are inside. You know, so it's never, you know, a blinded data analysis. And for these guys, we are using reversed phase liquid chromatography only in positive ionization mode. ESI is for electrospray ionization. There are different types of ionization, which you need to know before you start processing. You have to specify ionization modes in MS-DIAL. And instrumentation, maybe, yeah, you should know the type of instrument simply because of the, you know, what you consider a peak in terms of the peak height. And how data was acquired. Is it MS-1 only? Is it MS-MS as well? So here we will now use the 3 QC samples and 6 plasma samples. And we will process it in lipidomics profiling. There are 2 options when you open MS-DIAL. One of them is metabolomics and the other one is lipidomics. And by specifying one or the other, the databases behind get triggered, okay? So when we specify here lipidomics, LipidBlast and many other libraries that are running in behind are going to be activated and you will get you know, the hits based on that. So we're gonna process this. We're gonna also use in-house developed retention time MZ library. And we're gonna do some visualization and maybe some basic statistics in MS-DIAL. Okay. So the converted data is now found in this folder where the raw data was, okay? And the lipidomics text retention time MZ library is in this folder, okay? It is called text retention time MZ library. And the Lipidomics MSP libraries are integrated parts of MS-DIAL, so you don't have to worry about this right now, okay? Even if you are back at home, if you're processing some lipidomics data, the only different thing that you will be doing is you will not have this file, because you don't have the you probably don't have the same instrument or the chromatography that we do. But you can still go ahead, that was a question earlier, if you can still use this, you can. You just don't have the localized library, which is fine. There's still Lipid Blast in the back, and there's still MSMS databases that you can use. All right. Let's open MS-DIAL. MS-DIAL is, let me figure out how do I share my screen. Okay, so MS-DIAL is an icon on your desktop. Just double click. No. Oh. Thanks. Thanks. Hiroshi is updating MS-DIAL all the time. There are all the time new updates. So it happens often. Then even within 1 week, you install updates, and then 3 days later, there's a new update. So as I said before, usual recommendation is yes, you need updates. It's just right now we are gonna say no to this. Okay, I will just navigate you without me running it. I have some issues, it won't start. So, okay, you guys double click open MS-DIAL. This is the version or whatever version you guys have now opened is fine. And we will start up a project. The first and integral, the most important part right now is that you set up a project file path, okay? This is this guy right here, where you will have to click on the browse and go into the folder where we have just converted CSH ABF files, okay?
So
straight into that folder, not in the...
First file, new project.
Yes, file, new project, file, new project. Start a project and project file path. Thank you. Yes, your ABF files are in the
separate folder. Is it there in the separate folder?
So it is in the folder. Just a second. It is Ivana, ABF files, P20 CSHP plasma, and we will now go into the raw Agilent data file because this is where we converted the files. I have prepared some backups, okay? That's why there is another folder called ABF. If anything goes wrong with any of your computers, we would still have ABF converted files so you guys could still go and continue. So the correct... Yes, this is the pathway you should be setting, okay?
Yes.
ABF files, P20 CSHP plasma, raw Agilent data. I don't have the converted here because the converter wasn't working on this laptop. So you would have all of your ABF files here.
So, so we can't see it in the folder. So just press okay and that's it.
Yes, yes, yes. You cannot see it. You cannot see. Thank you. You cannot see the files. This is just the folder you will go now. You will set up the you will add the samples later. Okay.
One quick question. It's annotated with date and time. Is that okay?
Yeah, that's okay.
For sure.
Annotated with date
meaning,
and time.
Meaning when you choose age and data,
oh, okay. MTD. Yeah, MTD. MTD is the extension of the project. Okay, we have, as I said before, background information about this sample is that we have used electrospray ionization for the LC-MS, LC-MS-MS, or precursor-oriented GC-MS-MS analysis.
It says soft ionization.
Soft ionization.
Oh yeah, this is maybe changed with the new version. We're gonna use ESI. You still have ESI, right? Or does it still say? Yeah. So ESI is the correct one. Soft ionization.
This is the same.
Yes. So we will go forward and choose the soft ionization type. Project file path has been set to the folder where your converted data is. We will choose data dependent MSMS analysis.
So the file is slightly different menu.
I see.
So it looks
is
a little bit different.
Okay,
independent.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay. So the options that you can then choose is the ionization type, data-dependent MSMS, and the difference is, you know, some of these settings are gonna be different, but I will hopefully, you know, address it. All right, you should always know how the data was acquired. Was it acquired in the profile mode? How is the peak represented? Are there multiple dots representing one peak, or is it a stick representing a peak? Okay, it's very important because if you specify that it's in profile, what MS-DIAL will perform is the centroiding. Okay, so if you specify that it's in profile when in fact it's not, or the other way around, you just want to be alert on this. You have to know how the data was acquired. And in targeted omics, if you specify metabolomics, you are using user-defined MSMS libraries. They're user-defined, but they're publicly available. Okay, anybody can download them. We have them on the laptops for you. Or in the lipidomics, you don't have to specify anything. It's just gonna come up running from the background. So we're gonna go ahead and process the P20 CSHP plasma samples. So this is the project file path that you can open. We will use soft ionization. It's data-dependent MSMS analysis, and here it's important that you guys specify that the data is centroided, so therefore the software does not have to perform scent trading. And we have acquired data only in positive ionization mode, also important to specify. And targeted omics is lipidomics. Okay. You can hit next after this.
What about the MSMS? For profile or the centroid?
Yes. Okay. So right now, when you hit the next, the underlying window will pop up where you can browse and add the chromatograms you would like to analyze. Problem? When you hit browse, there will be a folder with .d files and .abf files.
Yeah.
Please control and select .abf files. Okay. Everybody okay? Yes.
Should we change the class ID?
Yes. Yes, okay. So there are some default settings that come with MS-DIAL, and this is the type of the samples, class ID, and the analytical order. So what you want to do is, we have the file names called QC pool MSMS. We have files called QC1, QC2, QC3, and then some samples. These are real biological samples which we will be processing. These are the NIST plasma, if I'm correct, which are used here as a quality control, and here is the quality control pulled for MSMS annotations. So please go ahead and as you add the samples, change the type or the class ID wherever you see the QC, add the QC. Wherever you don't see the QC, type the sample. This part, you change it here. It will not. You will not be able to change it later. And if you do change it here, visualization will be much nicer as we go on, because then you can just color code the visualization based on the type. Okay. Everybody, okay? You can hit next when you're finished. So this is just a tip when you are performing analysis back at home. So here we have two types of samples. One is called sample, the other one is called QC. QC stands for the quality control samples, which are injected in regular order between the actual samples. Say you have a study of 300 samples. You want to monitor the performance of your instrumentation. You want to see if everything is okay, you know, if there's any problems with the column, with the detector, whatever. So what we usually do is we inject 9 samples, and every 10th sample is a quality control. And we do this repeatedly. And then you can just extract from 300 samples all of the QCs with all of your internal standards, and you can monitor, you know, the fluctuation off of them, which is a nice thing, because whatever happens in your QCs, it also happens to your samples. So you can use QCs to normalize your samples. Very important. Yes?
But what do you do if you have like a change in retention time or something over?
Yes, fantastic. Yeah, fantastic. It, you will probably, if the longer the run, the more variation in your data, as it usually happens. And it also sometimes depends on the matrix, you know, and on the solvents that you use. But say if you have a very long run you know, hundreds or thousands of samples, you have to have a lot of QCs to account for this. And in your data processing settings, you will actually determine the window off of the retention time window for the shift off of the samples. What you can do actually, if the shift is too big, you know, sometimes on Helix we see some kind of shifts which is, you know, bigger, definitely bigger than on the CSH lipidomics. What you can do is you can use your internal standards like they do in the GC. They have retention index.
Yeah.
And you can actually just shift everything accordingly. You can do that as well. Just maybe not within this software right now. But let's say if you have, you know, thousands of samples, possibility for you to just align your data, if the shift is too big that you don't wanna, you know, give a huge window in the data processing settings, you can use your internal standards to, like they do in the GC with FAMES. Okay, so the class ID function can be also control versus treated, mice versus rat, I don't know. So you can do whatever you want. And analytical order is important. If you want to perform a QC normalization, okay? If you have 300 samples and every 10th injection was your QC, you can literally just click a button and say, I want to use lowest normalization. Then this normalization method takes the analytical order into account when adjusting for the data, okay? So let's go into the parameter settings. Data collection.
Anna,
yes.
You said you might use QCs to normalize your data. For example, we have 10 QCs for 100 samples. And if there is normalization, if you want to do normalization, how do you normally do this?
If I want to do normalization?
Yeah.
Okay. So one is it, I decide whether or not it's lipidomics experiment or not. I'm very lucky if it is lipidomics because these guys developed internal standard chromatography which has internal standards for every lipidomics class, which is fantastic. Because as you know, if you guys are, you know, these studies are super popular, this type of diet versus this type of diet, and then they do profiling of plasma. So if you have high fat diets, TGs may be higher, triacylglycerides, they may be higher, okay? And you will have a lot of triacylglycerides. Maybe they will be high abundant, but only they will be. Sphingomyelin may not change. So what you want to do is have internal standard that represents the whole class, and you can just normalize this class without accounting for all of the other guys. So in this case, I would use internal standards for the sample for the compound class, the normalization. If it's a helix, though, if it's a long study, like we did, I think Tobias had 3,000 samples for a golden analysis injected or something. So he has used lowest normalization. Just every 10th injection, it is done automatically. You don't have to you know, worry about this. Basically, it takes the QC samples because they should always be the same, okay? And they look at the intensities of the 10th injection versus 20th injection versus 30th injection versus 40th injection. If the peak intensity is dropping in the QCs, it's also dropping in your samples. So this normalization would just bring it back up. Super important, you know, nobody is dealing with raw data. And normalization and transformation of the data, this is Silifan and Dinesh are going to talk about this. You know, just as important as
acquired. This is actually treated in MS-DIAL, you mean?
Yes, you can
okay.
use some of the normalization methods
sure.
in MS-DIAL. You can.
So
okay.
Did I understand you right that just one type of lipid or five types of lipid can have a shift in retention time and the other ones are still okay?
It's not really a shift of on lipidomics. We don't really experience shifts in the retention time. It's just I'm saying that if you have triacylglycerides, okay, which are very high abundant in the people who eat high fat diet, let's say, and this is just the type of study you are doing, then internal standard that you have the uterate that's TG, some I don't know 40-2, may be super suppressed. Why? Why is it suppressed? Why is it not in the same intensity as the other one? Because it has co-eluting TGs from the sample which suppress just this internal standard.
Okay.
But you don't, you wanna, you know, this is called matrix factor and ion suppression. So what you wanna do is you wanna use this internal standard as your quality control, what is happening with your samples. If your internal standard is suppressed, there are other compounds which are also then suppressed. So you want to account for that.
Okay.
Yeah, retention time, am I wrong? Retention time in the lipidomics, we don't really. Okay, so here is an important part. When you, you know, do a method setup, you have to know the beginning and the end of how you acquire data. You may have 16-minute long chromatography, but maybe the last 4 minutes is just washing. You're not actually collecting anything. So in this case, we start collecting the data at 0.5 minutes and we stop collecting the data at 12 minutes. And the mass range, do you guys know why we are using right now here this mass range and not something else? Contaminants lower end. What if, what about like contamination versus, you know, size, mass size of the contaminants versus the small molecules? You can have a contaminant that has 900 mass and you can have also pyruvate, which has very low mass, okay? The reason why we are specifying here 300 Dalton and 1100 Dalton is this is the size of the lipids.
Mm-hmm.
Below 300 Dalton, we don't have lipids, okay? So this is just the reason. For the polar metabolites, as we will do in the next exercise where we will have helic, we will set this from 50 Dalton because there are many small molecules that, you know, from 50 Dalton upwards. So right now we're gonna use 300 to 1100. And the MS1 tolerance for this QTOF instrument is, yes?
Short-chain fatty acids are mainly analyzed by GC.
Yes, we do short-chain fatty acids on the GC, not on this extraction protocol. Yeah, good point actually. I should have mentioned that. So the MS1 tolerance for the QTOF instrumentation is 0.01 Dalton, and MS2 tolerance is 0.05 Dalton. Okay, so this is also instrument specific, and you should put a window for the LTQ, you should be using different settings. It's just for this instrument, for the QTOF, you should always be aware of the mass accuracy and the window you are using. Okay. So this is always as a default together with alignment. Please don't hit finish or next. We are gonna go to the next step, which is the peak detection.
Sorry, Ivanka. Could you explain the centroid parameters? What was that?
Centroid parameters?
Yeah.
Okay. So when you have the peak, right? Normally in the profile mode, you will have the peak, which is represented by
Gaussian
many.
Gaussian peak,
it's like
bell-shaped
peak. Yes, so Gaussian is just one form of distribution. There are many other forms of distribution. You may have a peak like this, which
bell
is not
peak.
Gaussian. So any type of peak in the profile mode is represented by the dots, okay? In centroid, you have just one peak. Okay, so this is you have one dot which is stick, it's also called stick spectra, which is representing the peak. So you are basically saying, okay, for me, for my type of you know, instrumentation and accuracy, I'm saying I am allowing for peak to be recognized at 180 Dalton plus minus 0.01 Dalton. This is the difference in mass accuracy you are allowing for a peak to be recognized. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
And a little bit broader, we always go with MSMS. And the reasons for this are, you know, various, and our panel Tobias will be covering more about MSMS, you know, analysis and what kind of window you should be using there. All right. So peak detection. Thomas today was talking about the smoothing methods and the importance of the smoothing methods. So there is a drop-down menu when you hit on this one. There are several ones we're going to be using today, linear weighted moving average. And we're going to be using a very slight smoothing, which is one scan, and minimum peak width. What we say with this parameter is we are saying how many scans are have to be there to represent a peak. I will explain this in a second. And the minimum peak height for Agilent instrumentation like this one, we are saying everything above 3000 we consider a peak, okay, in intensities. For example, somebody here was using Q-Exactive. Here we say 10,000, okay? The peaks are way, way higher, okay? So here we will be using 3,000 in amplitude, and mass lies with in 0.1 Dalton. So when you wanna see how broad your peaks are, you can just open the raw chromatogram from any browser you have. You can extract one mass, I don't know, EIC 350 or whatever you may be interested in. And you can see the peak width on the extracted ion chromatogram. Let's say if it's 0.1 minutes, okay? This is 6 seconds. So 6 seconds is a peak width. And the scan rate we set up on an instrument here, it's 2 scans per second. So you can then easily calculate how many scans you need that represent the peak. Right now we're gonna go with 5 scans and the height is gonna be 3000 in amplitude. We have also, yes?
So, sorry, the smoothing method. So depending on what should they choose?
Which smoothing method
yeah.
you should choose? Okay, so we are using right now a linear weighted moving average. I think this is the one we are gonna go with right now. I haven't actually tried the other two. It is...
So just stick to this one.
Yeah, I believe, you know, if you have, if you want to do a very quick experiment, you can just have one solution with 5 internal standards and you can try like 3 different smoothing methods. It's just, they're doing the same thing, just differently, but all of these smoothing methods are performing, in fact, smoothing. So there's no right or wrong, you know, it's just a personal preference, depending on your data. Right now we're gonna go with this one. And if you guys have known contaminants in your spectra, or if you have reference ions, okay, for these guys we have 121 and 921 or something like this. 922. Yes, 922. You can actually specify them in here, and you can say this mass plus or minus this many Dalton. I don't really want to see this in my you know, results file. You can exclude it here. Okay, this is the place for you to exclude it. You should actually think about if it's contaminants, don't just type in any masses. Maybe you should clean the instrument, you know, and the solvents and stuff. But for the time being, if there's anything you would like to exclude for whatever reason, this is the time to do it. Okay. We can go on to the smoothing level options. Thomas was talking earlier about this, you know, and Oliver, like 29 times smoothing and crazy stuff like this. So level 1 to 3 scans is optimal. When we say optimal, obviously not every single chromatogram in this world was tested. Usually when people are writing papers where they give a guidance to users out there, they take 300 chromatograms, maybe, from 3 different chromatographic methods, and then they test smoothing levels, and then they write a recommendation for users, okay? So it's just for you to understand that one general answer or one magic number is obviously not gonna cut it. But in most cases, or for most of type of analysis, especially right now, lipidomics and helix, very popular methods, we're gonna use 1 to 3 scans. Okay, peak width is expressed in scans, and they represent the data points for, collected across the peak. And this is one example that I explained earlier, how you can test the peak width. You know, you can really, you cannot really not know anything about your chromatography and say, oh, I'm just gonna do data processing. You always have to know, you know, stuff like ionization and peak width. Minimum peak height. It is a value based on the detector system used. And the users will always know it. If you are not collecting the data yourself, you can ask people who are operating the instruments. They will tell you, they know. And they can maybe also show you and explain why 3,000 and not 10,000. And this is what Thomas has observed. He's doing a lot of instrumental validation and a lot of evaluation and recommendations. So what he has observed is that for Agilent and SciEx QTOFs, it's 2,000 to 3,000 counts in amplitude. And for the thermo FTICR ion trap with 500,000 to 1 million counts. And the mass slice width is for the formation extracted ion chromatograms. Obviously, if you have internal standard, I don't know, 500, you're just allowing an instrument to extract 500 plus or minus, in our case, 0.01 Dalton mass deviation from that. Exclusion mass list, self-explanatory. All right, we're gonna go on to the MS2 deconvolution parameters. All right. So we talked a lot about the deconvolution, and this parameter is not easy. I'm still struggling to understand it. So there is a big equation, which I will display later, how this sigma window value is calculated. There's several formulas are somehow embedded in this, and there is a frame going from 0 to 1 for the deconvolution parameters. Okay, and the sigma window value is highly affected by the resolution of deconvolution. A higher value, meaning from 0.7 to 1, will reduce the peak top resolutions. And the result of this, that the results peaks will be decreased, okay? So the higher the number, the less resolved peaks. On the other hand, if you end up choosing lower values from 0.1 to 0.3, the software may recognize more actually noise as deconvoluted peaks. So this is why this value, basically we never change this. We leave it 0.5 for across all of the type of analysis. Okay. Okay. And here we are saying with MSMS abundance cutoff, I told you guys that this is also kind of important because not only in your scoring methods when you want to annotate and identify your compounds based on the fragments, there's a different type of scoring which is accounting for the ion intensity of those fragments. So right now we are saying, give me the fragments, I am not setting any intensity values, okay? Because different detectors, no, I mean, we are not evaluating for every compound the fragmentation pattern and intensity. So right now we are saying, just give us everything. We are not doing any cutoffs here. Okay. And exclude after the precursor. This is also a default. Once the compound has been fragmented, we are moving on. Okay. So, identification parameters. There are two major things we are going to cover here. One is the MSP file. MSP file is a format where all your MSMS data is stored, okay? This MSP file basically has, it's a very simple document. It has name of the compound, maybe UPAC name or INCI code or something like this. Then it has accurate mass. It tells you how many fragments this spectrum has. For example, for glucose, it may be like 22 peaks. And then you have a simple master charge list on one hand and the intensity on another one. That's all there is to it. It's just MZ versus intensity list. And you are specifying these guys here. And we are gonna use the MSP file that we have prepared for you guys. And the another type of identification is the localized database, which we also have in this case, and it's a text file. So what you want to do is set up the settings for Localized database, but in the lipidomics profiling, actually, those databases are running from the background, so you will not be able to, you don't have to specify them here. And another thing is, when you are using only other people's databases, like MONA database or MassBank or Metlin or any type of MSMS database, you do not wanna use these settings here. You have to type in something. So you don't have the chromatography like the people that collected the data have, obviously. So you wanna type in here something like 200 minutes or something, so you are covering everything they have like falsely, okay? And accurate mass, again, this is dependent on the instrumentation you have versus the instrumentation of the reference spectrum. And the identification score cutoff, again, you can be loose here and then decide for yourself. You can easily also put like 60% identification score, because it's just some kind of a formula that takes into account many parameters, such as accurate mass, peak intensity, presence of all of the product ions or some of the product ions. So you can go, you know, loose on this parameter. Okay. So you can guys go ahead and click onto the MSP file, select, and you should be able to see the lipid database settings. Everybody there? Yeah? So type of collision type, CID, there are many types how you can fragment the molecules. We are using collision induced dissociation here, so maybe this is already a default. The solvent type, we are gonna go with HCONH4, the solvent that was used for this type of analysis. If you have a different solvent which you are using, you may specify it. This is important for adduct formation.
But,
okay.
I'm sorry, I have a concern here, right?
Yes.
What if we want to do our experiment using a different solvent and different modifier? This is like, I think, the modifier inside the solvent they add. Then I have to add some adducts. Let's say, I don't see here, for example, maybe my compound is adducted with acetate,
yes.
Or adduct
with
acetonitrile.
Yes, acetonitrile adducts are very standard and you have them in the list. So this is a drop-down menu and all of the major solvents are covered.
It's only two.
Just two?
It's only
for
acid,
the
formic acid, ammonium formate and ammonium...
He's at the wrong window. She's talking about the right side where all the adducts are already there. You are talking about solvent type. There are only two types. On the initial, that is based on the derivatization also.
No, there's no derivatization.
No, sorry. I mean, he's talking about two in the solvent type window, whereas you're talking about
The
adduct. Whole drop-down, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So the adduct formation actually is not just solvent-based, okay? Adducts are occurring sometimes in source, sometimes with other.
My question is, if I have different setup of the experiment, how could I add my own adduct into this list?
Okay.
You know what I'm trying to say?
Okay.
Let's say I run my mobile phase methanol and water only without any modifier.
He's basically asking, is there any way we build our own MSP file,
okay,
having like whatever adducts, not just like
yes,
or other.
I get it. So first of all, if none of the adducts that you're interested in are here, there is always an option right here where you create a text file, which a template is also on the computer, where you can manually just exactly write whatever you want to write, especially if you know retention time, good. If you don't know the retention time, you don't. You can always create, multi-level. So you can use whatever is in there for your own convenience, but you can also add custom-made library.
Is this one of the things that gets updated if the new versions that keep coming out?
Yes.
Okay.
You mean
so if you already run your data and then you get new data, do you have to run all the
actually these are few different things. So the update of MS Dial that is reoccurring, it's in turn is regarding mostly the speed, the you know feasibility and stuff like this. So the peaking, none of these things are actually changing, and the libraries have changed only once. So Hiroshi just published, what was it, 1 month ago, I believe, a paper where he has in silico library for sphingomyelins, for ceramides, and I don't know, some other lipid classes. So this has happened once, and now it's improved, and it's already in there. And
that's since 2015.
Sorry?
That's once since 2015.
Yeah, it was 1 month ago,
right,
where
so
the library was.
That was the first library update since 2015.
Was
that's
it?
When the software came out, right?
The software came in 2015. Yes.
Okay. All right.
And this is the lipid library. I believe this is the first one since the lipid blast. So lipid blast was inside the whole time. And Tobias has updated the lipid blast. He's going to talk about this as well. But the new lipid species have been, I think, 1 month ago published and added in here. And I mean, you know, it's not just about if you have processed the data a year ago and you didn't have those lipids. You know, databases worldwide are growing as we speak, literally. So you can never ever be on top of things in terms of having your data annotated as people are uploading and sharing their spectra. So there's always some kind of, I'm sure if you wait with your samples 10 years, you'll have fantastic annotation rates, you know, 10 years from now. So.
But if you do one batch in like January and another batch of analysis in November,
oh
should
yeah.
you try to analyze them together?
Oof, so these are the guys that actually do these things, I think, much often, more than me. What do you recommend? If it's acquired, the data analyzed, extracted differently, data was collected differently, extracted differently, and analyzed
yeah.
differently. How would you perceive this wonderful study? How would you?
That would probably be separated into two different MS Dial experiments, and then later you can kind of do the alignment and the normalization.
Yeah.
That way,
but you shouldn't reanalyze the first time?
You can, yeah, you can easily reanalyze. You just, you know, download the latest version, you open up your file, and just, you know, hit go and reanalyze the data. So it's really easy.
Okay.
Let's compare with the biological part.
Yeah.
Data analyze result.
Actually, you know, this is one of the ongoing questions, and
yeah.
there are several NIH grants which are funding specifically these type of studies.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, some samples are just super difficult to get.
Mm-hmm.
I have this pilot project. It's premature delivery in women. It's a collaboration with Stanford University,
mm-hmm.
and they collected samples from women over the course of 5 years,
yeah.
and these samples, you know, they come completely, you know, different times, and different people have been handling them. So some of these samples have been on the bench for 2 weeks, some of them in minus 20, some of them in minus 80, completely, you know, differently, and we don't actually know what is happening with metabolome during this type of analysis.
Mm.
What is the degradation rate? We know for some. Acetyl-CoA, I can tell you, we've done this experiments, it disappears within minutes on coenzyme A's on having them on the bench. But for many other metabolites, we just don't know. So also, I would not be surprised if, you know, if you get also different results on such an experimental design.
Yeah.
All right. So what I was talking to you guys about before, this is the format how the file looks like. So you will have, for the PC, 36-1, it means it has 36 carbon numbers, atoms, and one double bond. In this database that we have a protonated adduct off of this PC. Molecular weight is this one. Precursor MZ is this one. We have the retention time, molecular formula. You can write any type of comment in here. Ha ha ha, it doesn't matter. And number of peaks is 6. This is very important when for computational people, when they want to compare one instrument versus another. Nobody really wants to open all these files and compare the peaks. You can just extract like this row and see how many peaks are produced with one instrument versus another instrument. And this is the peak list, okay? You get the intensity of the peaks. Some people write the comments in here, I believe, substructures off of the peak, off of this mass. And basically this is it. There's nothing more to it. And these MSP files are just stacks of this information, just one after another. It's very simple. Okay, so we're gonna go ahead and select some of the major adducts that we have in our lipidomics experiments. M plus H, M plus ammonium, sodium. You will find that most of the lipids, we have recently actually found out that they are sodiated or ammoniated. On the helix samples, mostly of them will be protonated, but lipids, they really prefer, these adducts are most abundant. We're gonna go ahead and choose some two M plus H's and ammoniated and sodium just to account for the dimers. Okay. Okay.
No.
No. No. No. Okay. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And finally, we have the alignment tab. So when you are processing your stuff with MS-DIAL, these parameter settings can be saved and your alignment result will also be saved. And it will be given immediately in name. So if you are not happy with your first processing, you can very, very easily and super quickly say, oh, I'm just gonna real quick reprocess my data, and you can then compare different smoothing methods, one versus another, different, I don't know, peak width methods, or whatever you are interested in. You can do this very easily. So, reference file. Something important for the alignment. You are basically saying in this step, which file should all of the features be aligned against. Thank you. So you are saying, usually you would not want this to be a method blank, okay? If you have every third injection method blank, you don't want to have features basically from the real biological samples to be aligned with a complex biological matrix. You don't want them to be aligned with the method blank that has just the solvent. So in this case, we're gonna go and say the QC2, and there's a reason. Usually, if you're analyzing urine sample, but your QC is spinach, you know, many labs, they have just one QC for regardless. You don't wanna use the spinach to align urine data, so you are just gonna go ahead and choose one of your early samples as an aligning file. Okay. So we're gonna go ahead and do this one, and retention time tolerance, we are we know we don't have retention time shift, so we go and put 0.1 minutes. Every feature with the accurate mass of such and such, which was recognized as peak, will be aligned plus or minus 0.1 minutes from the reference file. This will be binned together. MS1 tolerance, right now the peaks have already been picked. So we are saying, right now in the alignment, there should be no changes in mass, basically. So we are going to write 0.025 Dalton, okay? And retention time factor, you can put, I think this is actually for the GC. We're gonna go and say a peak count filter, you can say here 50%. If you have a study with multiple groups, okay, treatment 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I don't know, you don't wanna put any number in here because you may have, here you are basically saying 50% aligned peaks which are less than this parameter will be removed. So here you are saying 50% of the features which are not present across of them will be filtered out. So you are here saying that one compound has to be present in at least 50% of the samples. For this study is fine, but imagine if you had four groups within one study and you put something in like this. You may have that one compound is present just in one treatment group, mm-hmm. okay? So you wanna account for this.
How does that account for which peak?
Sorry?
Like, I don't think I get it because, so say for instance that it's saying that the triglyceride peak or something has to
Sorry?
Be, so that the triglycerides have to be present for it to be a valid sample, otherwise it's gonna be excluded.
No. It is alignment. We are in the alignment. It's a good question, good point I'm realizing now. So you are basically here saying that aligned peak, so if you have one peak, one compound, let's say 36:1, which is present only in three samples out of 20,
mm-hmm.
you're getting rid of this compound in this filter.
Why do you want to do that?
You don't.
Oh.
So that's what I'm saying. Right now we are using 50%. We are saying that every compound that has to be present in at least 50% of the across the aligned samples. Okay? I'm just saying for you when you go home, if you have four groups analysis or something, you really don't wanna put a stringent number here because you may have, I don't know, serum mice which are present only in pregnant mice plasma samples.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, no, that's a great point.
So would you normally have that set to zero? Or would you have it at like 5% or?
Yeah, I put zero. What do you guys put? Also zero? Yeah. I don't do it here. I really don't. I believe it's, you know, it's too early unless you have, you know what, when you have technical replicates. You know, when you are just evaluating, some people, they just evaluate their instrumentation across time. This is where you would actually want to see how many peaks, you know, are reoccurring, what is the reproducibility of your research. This is actually the type of study when you would want to compare just the features that are that should be there. But in
but
any
wouldn't
other
you also want to know then if it's not? Like if
yes, you do.
Matching?
Also, yes. Yes. So I personally keep this to the zero. The guys as well. It's just right now we're gonna end up with a table with hundreds, if not thousands, of peaks, which we will then have to process. So right now we're just trying to, you know. Okay. So we are saying here QC as the last filter. In this exercise, quality control is also a plasma sample, okay? So we are just gonna go ahead and say the option that all aligned peaks must be present in the all QC samples. But even though our QC is plasma, okay, it's specific type of plasma which is purchased, NIST plasma, and our biological samples are a different kind of plasma. So if you were to hit a check mark here, all aligned peaks must be present in all QC samples, you are basically saying that the metabolome of the biological experiment should be the same as your quality control, which we don't want to. So this please decheck, okay? It has to be empty. Okay, we can go ahead and click finish if you guys are okay with this. And we are just gonna go and look over the files when we're done. It will take some time. It's quick, but it's still a few minutes before the peak. Everybody's processing now?
Yes.
Okay.
How much it take you to, well, depend on the.
It depends on the size, data.
For example, for this.
3 minutes,
yeah.
Something like this. You have to do it again.
Do I?
I don't know. Is it closed?
I did it, but I accidentally received it.
Oh, that's it.
You're finished already.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Everything's okay.
Yes. All of the QCs and all of the samples, they have all of them have the same extraction solvent, and the extraction solvent contains the thermal standards. So it's a good question. Yes. Yes, exactly. So I can see there is a slide saying that between actual samples. So usually it's in, let's say, 9 samples and then a QC.
Okay.
And then a 9 sample and a QC. It's just right now we.
Just the full
information.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Are you guys finished?
No,
mm-hmm.
No, I'm still processing.
Okay. Any questions I may answer while this is processing? There was one question here, a good question. If the QCs that we have here have internal standards? It's a great question. So when we extract our samples, we pretend also that the QCs are being extracted together with the samples. So the solvent used for this contains the internal standards. So we will always have the internal standards across the run. This is important.
If you lose one or two biological samples by mistake,
mm-hmm.
from your like, say you have 8 classes and you lose, for example, 2 samples from class 7 or whatever, you need to pull your QC, the number of replicates vary, biological replicates, or it's going to make this effect.
So when you say you lose them, you don't have them anymore?
A flask fall now. If it's broken.
Okay, and you don't have any backups, you mean? Or
no.
Okay, well, then you just have to continue with the analysis with what you have. But
what about the QC, the pool for the QC? Shall I do a new QC for the available samples?
Yes, because if you have, I mean, the pooled QC can only contain the pooled samples from the samples that you are measuring.
Yeah, but
so
for example, if class A has 4 replicates and they lose 2 replicates from it.
Okay.
So the concentration will vary because it will, the pool will take from all the replicates, right?
Yes.
So class A, for example, has 4 replicates, I lose 2. So the concentration of the metabolites there, it will be less in the pool than other classes that contain 4 replicates.
Okay.
Which won't be big effect.
So the pooled samples are not used for quantification at all. So the concentration, it's just relative concentration. We use the pooled samples only to perform like MSMS analysis on the one sample rather than injecting.
So it's not effective if the number of replicates in class one, there is a slight variation.
You will not be able, honestly, to do any kind of plots with 2 replicates because every single bar plot and every single graph needs upper bound value and lower bound value, and you have to have a mean to calculate, which means minimum is 3 statistically. If you ask Oliver and Celie, they will tell you minimum is 6 actually in metabolomics. So with papers are not really going well through the review system if you have just 2.
No, I don't mean 4 or 2. I mean I lose some variables. Let's say 10 and I lost 2.
Okay.
8.
Yes. So I see you're wrong. So the pooled samples and the intensities in the pooled samples, of course, yes, it will be affected, but we are using the pooled samples only to aid structural elucidation in this process. Okay, that's all. And if you want to, if the follow-up question basically was to see the do you use the pooled samples, how it aligns between the samples? Is that what you want us to?
There might be a slight shift for the QC, right? It won't be centered between the sample or the plots of the samples if there is slight lose of them.
Oh, I think I see what you mean. So one, there is a QC, which is here.
Like in
one,
ABCA, I mean, it will not
the, we have here two things which are QC. Okay, you see QC, 1, 2, 3. This is quality control of the instruments. And then there is a pooled QC where that is helping us with structural elucidation, because this is the guy we are fragmenting. So two different things, okay? Your QCs and the or you can still be, you are still able to use the QCs. You're not using pooled QC to do normalization. We're not using that. Okay.
Okay. Now I'm a little confused. Let me repeat my understanding and please correct me. You have two different QCs. You have a QC which mixed with real samples. And this real sample QC, you perform MS on it for structural elucidation and library matching.
Yes. He's nodding,
yes.
Yes.
It's a pooled QC. You basically take three samples and mix them together, three samples,
yes.
Mix them together, and this is your pooled QC to do MS experiment,
yes.
On them.
Correct.
So later, you do the library match for structural elucidation.
Yes.
Meaning it's a true mixed sample.
Yes.
Now the QC1, QC2, QC3 is what you purchase from NEST.
Yes.
These with known compound, so you will run them, you understand the retention time ahead of the experiment, you know everything about this QC samples, and you run them within your experiment, so you do normalization against them.
That's correct. This is one of the options. You don't have to use the QCs.
Sure.
It's just one of the options you
but
are left with.
What's the rule then of the internal standard set you add inside the sample?
What's
what is
the function?
Rule? Yes.
Okay.
What is the function of the internal standard you're adding?
Okay.
Can you do this?
No.
Okay. So there was one of the figures before was if you have internal standard, which always is looking like this.
Yes.
Okay. This is your internal standard. You have a very thick matrix.
Yes.
You have somebody's urine who hasn't been drinking water.
Absolutely.
And the creatinine in that sample is gonna be something like this. And your internal standard is not gonna be anymore at this level. It's gonna be something like this. This
sure.
Is your new intensity. New intensity of your internal standard. You know it's
yes.
Fake.
Yes.
You know it's suppressed.
It's suppressed.
Yeah, so this is an indicator, basically, of telling you something about the biological matrix
yes.
You are using. So this is one function off of the internal standard you may use. Another function off of the internal standard is for lipidomic studies, where you have different internal standards for each lipid class.
Yes.
So this may happen only for one of the lipid classes, but not for the other guys.
Sure.
So you still want to be able to normalize your data accordingly.
Okay.
Maybe it happens only for the TGs,
yes.
But your internal standard is going to be maybe suppressed.
Right.
So you're basically monitoring A, or what if detector is faulty?
Yes.
Detector is faulty, you will see it also on the intensity of your internal standard.
Absolutely.
So internal standards are telling you two things. One, how is the biological matrix looking? Do I have ion suppression? And B, how is the instrumental settings working?
Yes.
So
yes.
This is the function of the internal standards. Have I answered the question?
Yes, yes, absolutely. But also we could use them to study the relative ratios of certain analyte and compare them between cross the samples.
So you
like
mean
for example, if I have two control sample from patients versus control normal patients, then I could say, okay, let's say cholesterol here increased, and this is how much increased relative to the internal standard I'm adding.
Okay, I see. So
it's some sort of semi quantification.
So unfortunately, if the detector is saturated,
yes.
There's no
yes.
Correlation.
Yes. Yes. I understand.
It's
I could see what you say.
Yes. So if it's actually 10 million saturated in the detector, in fact it could be 12 million, it will still show 10 million. So there is no correlation with saturated peaks. There's only one solution, I don't know, maybe more solutions which you can do, but I would strongly suggest diluting the sample.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yes.
So have you guys used this pooled MSMS on other anti-PD metabolomics, or only for the lipid omics?
No, in every experimental design we use this. We always acquire MSMS data.
No, yes, but this kind of like MS1 for the real sample and the pooled sample for the MSMS.
Okay, so MSMS is here just to help you with the database matching, right? And for the, it has to be run in the same run so you can align everything accordingly. That's all.
For other like untargeted, it might be more complicated than only the lipid omics. You will have a lot of weird things. So now you're pulling them together.
What do you think that pooling might cause? You are concerned if the pooling might
not representing the real sample, like.
Oh, you don't have to pull, obviously. No, you don't have to pull. You can. This is just one of the methods how you can acquire MSMS data, which we did for this guy. Usually, I mean, you have always the option to inject exactly the same sample and acquire in the same run MS1 and MSMS analysis. You can always do that. And therefore, you will have MSMS spectra associated only with this sample, MSMS spectra associated only with a different sample. You don't have to worry, yeah.
True, but you might need a very fast machine if you don't have that option.
Fast machine, it's the same speed. Speed never changes when you say, I'm gonna run. It's the same time needed.
Yeah, let's say we have a 6550, but if you have a Q-exactive HF, definitely we're gonna go for that, because that one's faster than the 6550, which is not very good for the, you know, DDA, MSMS.
I'm sorry, my understanding is that UTOF is the fastest, and
true,
that's why it is the good machine for to do metabolomics,
yes,
and complex samples.
Yes, but not QTOF. Triple top. QTOF, like the Angelin 6550,
yes,
is not very good for the MS2.
It's not
that
good
speed,
for MS2?
Like only 2 scans per second, let's say that.
Okay.
But triple top, you can go to like 20.
Okay. So, not good meaning like you cannot use it for structural elucidation, you can still use it. I mean.
True. But which method you're going to use, like pooled MSMS or combine everything into the same run, like MS plus two MSMS.
Yeah, so on the QTOF, we generally will either, you know, select samples or pool treatment groups, depending on kind of the size of the study, and just inject after, so run all of our MS1, and then using those same samples, just, you know, run maybe 10 to 15 MSMS injections. So that's kind of how we go about it. Using the actual sample for QTOF, as opposed to, you know, triple top or Q-exactive, where you can just run MS and MSMS. But part of that is also kind of the trade-off with the QTOF is you're creating sensitivity for your MSMS or scan speed, and the triple top and Q-exactive are trading resolution. So always a balance.
Yeah. We can discuss this maybe also in detail with Thomas. He's doing most of the development, or Shen with development of the instrumentation and testing of the different instruments. And Tobias can then maybe better answer how does this affect MSMS spectra. So we can revisit your question. Okay, everybody here? Yes. Okay. So just to give you a short overview of the navigation, how does everything look like? So here on the left, you have the file navigator where all of your samples are listed. You can click on each of them individually if you want to inspect, if you know what you are looking for. Here we have the labeling options and the filters. How do you want to visualize your data? And this, if you remember from the beginning, we have set here the labeling from the before. We set QCs and the samples. Here is the display of these extracted ion chromatograms, so you can always extract the masses you are interested in for whatever reason. Here on the right-hand side, we have the peak information, okay? It tells you the peak intensity, the abundance of the peak, it tells you the retention time, averaged across the alignment, it tells you the accurate mass, it tells you the compound name, from which is getting the information from the library hit, and it gives you, yeah, just if you have a match with MSMS, libraries, databases, it gives you actually an MSMS similarity score. Tobias is going to talk about this more. It's important information for non-experts to interpret this score carefully. So you get a score ranging from 0 to 1000. The higher the better, obviously. Everything above 900 is considered excellent, actually. And so this is for, you know, if you are wondering what's the compound I'm looking at, if there's a score something like 500, you may wanna perform additional steps of structural elucidation. Use MS Finder, Arpana is gonna discuss this, or there's some other things you can do. Okay, so here we have the peak viewer. Basically every single feature is represented as a peak here, as a dot. Excuse me. And these dots are color-coded, okay? And this is basically the reality of metabolomics. If you guys go ahead and say display identified, if you go ahead and click this, all of these gray spots are gonna disappear and you will end with maybe, if you're lucky, 10% of annotated compounds. And this is just the reality. Don't, when you go ahead and do the data processing, or if you have already received from somebody else data processing, 90% roughly of compounds are really unknowns. We don't know any information at this step. There are some things you can do, but at this point right now, this is the ratio we are dealing with. And on the same, when you go with the cursor, with your cursor on those dots. On your left-hand side, you will see MS1 spectrum, okay? So this is the peak you're interested in. This is the stick spectrum, which is represented as a dot here. And on your right-hand side, if there was an MSMS database matching, you will see something like this. Experimental spectra versus the standard reference spectra in the database. So you can see basically back-to-back MSMS analysis comparison.
Can you please tell us about the colors of the spots?
The colors of the spots?
The green or red
different
colors?
Yes, so we will come to this. So in this data set, the color coding is depending on the labels that you set up earlier. And here, since this is an inbuilt in silico library for the lipids, here you will have different classes of lipids will be displayed as different colors. Just for your visual, the chromatography was developed as such that you have a different eluting times for different lipid classes.
But so, I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Yes.
So, say for instance, you spike your sample with something that is deuterated, right?
Yes.
So like a deuterated trace, right?
Yes.
And then basically the red peak down there is that, or like the red whatever on the bottom, and then the blue is your sample in the spectrum. I just want to make sure.
No. So the deuterated mass is different from the real T. Let's say if we have the deuterated TG.
Ah, so you can separate. Them.
Yes. This is the yes.
Then I don't understand again what the red and the blue is.
Okay, so you have a MSMS database library that somebody else created across the world.
Lipid Blast or something.
This is annotation used with Lipid Blast, but also it has MSMS library for the lipids. Okay, MSP
and
libraries.
You guys made in-house.
This one is already inbuilt. It's a collection of everything from everywhere in the world.
Okay.
It's just so that it's right now located within the MS dial.
So that you know what a tremulous rank is supposed to look like.
Exactly. So
okay.
This is for your convenience to see what the reference spectra that somebody else purchased and measured on the similar, the same instrument, what it looks like and how does your experimental data compare to that.
Okay.
And you can either look at this guy right here. You can look at it here, okay? Or if you're not interested in, you know, explaining all these peaks that your measured spectrum has, you can just use this core right here. Ooh, 961, that's pretty good. This is, you know, my compound. So you can always refer, you can either do manual inspection of the overlapping peaks of what you have in your samples versus the standard. Or just look at this guy and say, oh, I'm pretty happy. Also, when we will export the data, you will have those scores in your library. So you can just filter, if you're uncomfortable, you know, manually interpreting the data, you can just filter and say, I only want peaks more than 700 with the similarity score.
Okay, so the blue is your sample, the red is the library.
Yes.
And does this merge in those adduct ions that are like not falling in the same?
Great question. So MSMS analysis is the fragmentation off of the precursor, okay? If a precursor is protonated, you will have neutral mass plus 1,007, which is the mass of 1H ion. But if it's sodiated, let's say, it will be this mass plus 21. If it's ammoniated, I cannot calculate. I don't know this right now. But you get the idea. So the precursor mass will change with the adduct type. So absolutely great question. So you have your precursor mass here. And right here, it will tell you exactly the species which it is. Great, great question. I forgot to mention this. So different types of compounds will form different lipids. And the precursor mass obviously depends on this. Is it the mass? In this case, we are talking only about the increase of mass because we are in positive ionization mode. So it's always plus something. So in this case, it's plus ammonium, you see right here. So TG 50 to 1 means it has 50 carbon atoms and one double bond. And this, if you calculate, you know, manually the neutral mass of this, it will be, I don't know, some number. But the mass which was fragmented was this mass plus this guy right here, ammonium, okay? So this fragmentation of lipid which you are comparing is ammoniated triacylglyceride.
So up there on the compound name, it says triglycerides 50:1, and then like another like semicolon. So is that basically like the compound and the adducts like all joined together magically?
No.
No.
So also great question and great observation. So all we know actually about this TG is that it has 50 carbon atoms and one double bond. But where is it?
Yeah.
You know, triacylglycerides, it means there are three chains, right?
Yeah.
So what is the length of this chain? Is it 16? Is it 18? Is it again 16? I cannot tell you. And nor can this spectrum right now tell you this, okay? So we know that this TG is 50 to 1, and this is one of the, this guy right here, it tells you that the first chain has 16 and zero double bond. Then it tells you that the second chain may have 16 and again zero double bonds, and then the third chain will have 18 carbon atoms and one double bond. We don't know this right now,
okay,
for sure. For certainty, we can say that it's 50 to 1, but basically this equals this.
So the blue thingy is one of these. It could be either one.
Yes, because it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter
for
the LCMS analysis. Yeah.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter where this double bond is. Okay.
Yeah.
The mass will not change. The retention time will not change. This order right here of the length of the chains, it can be in any order. Retention time on the LC instrument will not change, nor will the mass change. So we are just comfortable saying that we know that this is the TG 50 to 1, we just don't know which isomer it is. We just don't know which position of the chains it is. Tobias is gonna cover this in depth with you guys, I think, next week probably.
So it's highlighting to the reader that that you're not sure.
Sorry?
So it's just highlighting to the reader that you're not sure yet.
Yes.
Yeah, perfect, sorry. Thanks.
Awesome. I thought when you weren't sure, instead of a slash, it was an underscore. Am I getting that backwards? Like, if you weren't sure of the order, then it was an underscore between, like, the 16 to 0 underscore 16 to 0 underscore 18 to 1. And I thought there was a slash there instead, that meant that was the order.
So the slashes and stuff, so this annotation right here, it's coming from the database. And this database may come from anybody else. Like I said, you can make almost type in ha 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 and upload it, you know. That's why I said this. This is the compound name that somebody has put in of this reference, TG50:1. So we don't know, somebody, the person that created this spectrum, that created the reference spectrum, they may have had this TG in this order. 16 to 0, 16 to 0, 18 to 1. They may have had that. But what if we have different distribution of the same TG50? There are combinations of the TGs, of the length of the chain can be different. It doesn't have to be the same. But it will still have the same spectrum here. It's still the same accurate mass, still the same carbon number, and it's still the same unsaturation level. Therefore, LC analysis is not suitable for stereochemistry determination. This is stereochemistry, how the chains are.
But I thought there was a difference between the slash and the underlying. Is anyone else remembering this from a lecture?
Yeah.
We just
yeah.
had
yeah, but that's
yeah.
only, there's a paper and that Thomas just showed us, right? So
yeah.
that's like, we should do it.
Oh,
right, and
we
so you're saying
it,
that because
this is somebody
else
already did
this.
It and it might be wrong.
Yeah.
Okay, I will check this before, I will talk to Thomas and get back to you about this, okay? Just so we are everybody, so I'm not saying.
Okay, but when we're taking this from the database, we shouldn't trust that is in any way a correct order. It could
yeah.
be any.
Right.
Yes,
right.
Because we cannot account for the stereochemistry using the LCMS, or is it cis or trans? Sometimes you will have cis annotation here. How do you know that you have cis conformation and not trans with, you know, LCMS experiment? You cannot. NMR can tell you this. It's just right now, I will talk to Thomas about this to confirm.
But based on Thomas' presentation, we can do with the MS. The conformation.
Yes,
yeah,
Thomas is very, very good at this.
Yes. Fragmentation of the ions.
Yes, Thomas is very, very good at this. And so how the compound is breaking, the rules of this, Tobias is gonna discuss them, okay? And like I said before, if you have, let's say, citrate and isocitrate, maybe it's not the best example right now because we're talking about lipids, you will have sometimes the exact same fragmentation pattern of the two isomers. It's just the ratio of these fragments' intensity and the ratio to them between themselves will be different, which will tell you which is which, okay? So to talk about the structure elucidation, in depth, you will cover this very, very well with Tobias and with Rapana next week. So I will just move on with this and but I will still get back to you after I talk to Thomas about this.
So what I observe here, some of the peak doesn't show any MS2. That's correct?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So not every feature, not every precursor mass was fragmented, okay? In this particular experimental design, you are just saying every abundant compound please fragment it and enter it into quadruple. Not everything. Okay. So if you hadn't figured out how it's working, you can zoom in and zoom out using the mouse functions. You can select and scroll. You can double click to select and deselect the files in the file navigator. And if by doing the right click, you can also do some some, you know, exporting functions and similar. Okay, if you guys go onto the view option, you can choose to display total ion chromatogram or TIC, and you can also choose to display extracted ion chromatogram, EIC short. And for the EIC, you can also specify what is the mass you're interested in. Okay, and on the lower left window are the internal standards which we are using for this lipidomics analysis, and you can see their peak shape and they're color coded down there. So if you type in the name in the EIC window, extracted ion chromatogram, for your convenience, you can just type in ceramides 22 to 1, and you can. This is the exact mass off of this internal standard. And the mass tolerance for the extraction that we are setting is very narrow, 0.02 Dalton. You will be able to display the internal standards if you want to look at them in the window. And you can do the same for, I don't know, you can just do one or two for fun. It's not really, you can do one ceramide and I don't know, one DG.
Okay, of course.
Okay. All right, so this is just how you can see the total ion chromatogram off of your run, how it looks like. It's important to know sometimes where your compounds elute. And for the extracted ion chromatogram, you can see, you know, you can just extract your internal standards, for example. For the visualization off of the data, you can choose several options. You can use retention time, master charge ratio, metabolite name, isotope or adduct, or whatever. Peak spots, you can filter them according to peak intensity, okay? Display filter identified shows identified peaks which have been confirmed with MSMS spectrum. Annotated are showing the ones from that do not have MSMS. Molecular ion shows the DE isotope molecular ions. MSMS, sometimes you have MSMS spectrum, it's just they're not, you don't have a match in a database, okay? This also happens. And then there is unknown, completely unknown, you don't have any annotation whatsoever associated with them, okay? These are just different ways how you can label or visualize the data within the software. Yes. Here, no. Right? We cannot, there's no option to do this. Yes. But if you do like the TICs, you would like to see if there's a drug.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. You can. Yeah, I know. So there is no option here because everything is aligned already here. So, but if you are interested in overlaying total ion chromatograms, you can do this on the vendor software right after the run. You can just overlay all of the TICs and see, you know, how it looks like. Yes.
You said that there's some like basic stats that you can do in MSDial. Can it be used to calculate like a relative abundance, or if you're using like targeted, can it be used for quantification or semi quantification?
Yeah, so all of the intensities here are the relative intensities. You can have the calibration curve. You can also have that, right? You can create your own calibration curve with absolute concentrations, which you can then later on calculate for your sample. But right now, all of the intensities that are here are relative intensities. Yes. Okay, so again, the peak viewer, when you zoom in into one of these dots, you get three things. On your left is MS1 spectrum, up is the extracted ion chromatogram, and on your right, if you have MS data for it, and if there's a match in your database, you will get a back-to-back comparison, database versus experimental. Okay, so question about the colors. Somebody asked before, we have LPEs and LPCs that elute very early onto the lipidomics chromatography we have, followed by DGs, ceramides, PEs, PCs, sphingomyelins, and here we have again the TGs at the very end. And this is just true for our chromatography. Obviously, if you have your own chromatography, which is different than this one, you may have different order off of the lipid classes. You can also save your spectra, you know. For whatever reason, you may wanna see how your spectra looks today versus some other time in the future. You can save it as TXT or MSP or MGF file. And this is how the output looks like. Remember, you can put here the names, you can put any type of comment you want, retention time information. So you can basically create your own local MSP file if you want to do this. You can also share it with other people if you want to do this. So when you save it, you can do this you can do this directly from MSDial into the format which anybody anywhere can use in this format. Okay, you can do this, or I don't know, upload it as a supplemental material for the paper you just wrote. So you have that option. And again, it's already automated, so it will give you the peak number, it will give you the message charge ratios and the intensities for that peak for each of the fragments, and you can just save it and or share it with other people.
Can you handle a batch export? Like, let's say all identify export at the same time, once.
I don't know. Can you do batch export? I haven't tried, actually. Batch export of all of the MSMS data collected? No, right? No, it's per peak, yeah, unfortunately. Brian?
Yeah.
The export off of the MSMS data obtained in MSDial, can you do batch export?
Of the MS data?
Yeah, that you have collected. Can you just say from, please export all of the MSMS spectra from this analysis into MSP file?
It will let you select what files, what samples you want to export.
No. It's no. So the MSP exportion.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I've never tried to export MSMS from. That's where you do the annotation.
Yeah, I haven't tried it, but I know for sure for Agilent, for example, you can export directly all of them together. You can just say export as MSP, and all of them will be there. It's just you won't have any annotations from within the. Yeah. Okay. So. Yeah, you can. So a visualization off of the MS2 spectrum, you can zoom in and you can have a look in depth for the compound search. You can also connect your MSMS data to MS Finder for further structure elucidation. I couldn't open it.
Okay.
waiting for. Because it was in the panic mode, they started. They opened one and it just wouldn't open.
Did they have exercises to do or something?
Yes, yes, but it worked. It worked. It worked well.
You can just tie them, you know.
Yes.
Get some.
Okay. It's fine. Let me just.
It's.
Okay. So again, somebody asked earlier the criteria for unified peak identification. It is defined with several equations, and all of them are utilized for the peak identification, okay? And again, this is the type of scoring for the similarity, dot product and dot product reverse score, and the total score is just the combination of all of these parameters. MSMS similarity, MS1 similarity, retention time similarity, and isotope ratio similarity. All of these things contribute together to the total score off of your identification compounds, okay? So alignment spot viewer, if you double click on your alignment result, you will be able to see all of the aligned spots, something like this, for multiple runs off of one dot, okay? So you may have some slight shifts in either the mass or the retention time across your run, and you can see basically how the same compound behaved across multiple injections and how they were aligned together, okay? And this is the retention time right here. It goes from 10 minutes 515 to 10 minutes 540. Okay, 0.03. Very good. Okay, we're just gonna have to speed up a little bit because we don't have that much time left, and you still have to go and do the MS Flow exercises. And the alignment navigator, you also have the identification setting. Okay, say you wanna, you're not happy, you made a mistake or whatever. You don't have to go through the process of peeking all over again. You can just say, I'm gonna re-annotate again with a broader window, or I'm gonna re-annotate again using a different library, okay? You have this option, and it will be at this time and place very quick. So you can just choose the identification settings and the new alignment tab will appear and with the new results. Okay. So here is the peak list result. You have the possibility to export the peak list for one or more samples, and you can export them in three different formats. And you can actually then do the batch exporting. You can add and export all of them and just choose the MGF file to export. I just haven't done that yet. And okay. So we will now export the results, and those results that we export, you will be processing later on with Brian to remove the duplicates, isotopes, and combining different adducts in your next exercise. So you can just go ahead and choose the directory where you want to save your results. And you have several options that you can export. And the alignment result, you can also choose. If you have multiple alignment results, you have to specify which one you want to have exported. And you can choose the format for the exporting, okay? Usually we do the text. You can then just drag and drop to Excel table to inspect the list. But usually this is how we do it. Okay, everybody exporting? Yes.
In this case, how can you handle the missing data?
sample has a compound and another one doesn't?
Yes.
So, and you expect it to have, or what do you mean? It's nothing. So, the peaks are aligned across all of the samples, but if there is, we set here a 50% feature cutoff. We said if this compound is not present in 50% of the samples, delete it. This is what we said before, okay? But you can set this number to zero. And then you say, it's okay if it's present in just one sample. You can manually or later determine with your analysis if this compound is of importance or not. There's a filter that you can set for this. Yes. Okay, so, everybody, please export your results, and when we will have a 5-minute break, and when we come back, we can do a re-identification with some change settings off of the samples. Okay, 5-minute break.